The next few moments are devoted to silent prayer. That gives each of you as a believer priest the privacy of your priesthood to rebound if necessary. For if we name our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to purify us from all wrongdoing. When we name our sins to God, we are filled with God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit is our mentor and our teacher, and the one who brings to our memory those things we have forgotten. So with that in mind, let us pray. Father, we thank you for the freedom and privilege to assemble ourselves together for the purpose of learning your word. May God the Holy Spirit enlighten us and challenge us by what we note. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. I've given you several handouts that we'll look over as part of our study of freedom and as part of our what we're getting into now, the concept of the client nation to God. Now, if you look at the first handout I gave you, it's referencing the history of income tax rates adjusted for inflation from 1913 to 2010. You can see that in 1913 there were seven income tax brackets. But you see the rate is from 1% to 7%. Wouldn't that be the glory days? That was a time when we had a lot of freedom, but you can always already see the concept of a progressive tax rate. In the Old Testament, it was always a flat tax. That 10% that the Baptist wants you to pay, that's not referencing the church age. That's referencing a 10% tax rate to the treasury of Israel. It's for the function of their government administration and so forth. And the Jews had three 10% tax rates, making theirs 30%. And then every third year they had to pay a 10% poor tax, which effectively made it 33.3% a year across the board, rich or poor. So God is for a flat tax. But you see how this country started in freedom. And then in 1917, we had a very liberal professor who was in office. His name was Woodrow Wilson. It says there, World War I financing, baloney. It was Woodrow Wilson who was trying to use socialism in this country. And you can see the number of tax brackets went from 7 to 21. The tax rate went from 1% from the bottom rate to 2%. The top rate went from 7% to 67%. Talk about a shock to the system for those who were industrious in making money for this country. What a horrible thing. And notice, it's progressive. And we've had this all since 1913. And we have been on a type of decline ever since. The tax rates came down during the Roaring Twenties. That's why they were roaring. They came down to 1.5%. The highest rate was 25%, and there were 23 brackets. And the highest rate, by the way, began when you made $100,000. The highest rate for Woodrow Wilson began at $200,000. It must be. It can't be 2,000. And the highest rate for 1913 began at 500,000. And then in 1932, in 1925, there was that tax cut, and then the Roaring Twenties, and then came the Great Depression. And then we had the inauguration of President Roosevelt. And during this time, tax rates went from the bottom rate up to 4% to the top rate of 63%. Well, that didn't work. So the idiot reduced the brackets but made the taxes higher from 4% to 79%. Well, that didn't work. So the idiot raised the taxes from the bottom rate of 10%, top rate 81%, beginning at, that's either going to be $5 million. Okay. So where there it's $2 million in 1917, it's $5 million. If you made $5 million a year, you were taxed at 79%. And this is during the Depression era. And by the way, Roosevelt did not get us through the Depression. The Depression kept going and going and going and going. They revise history, just like if we have a history left in this country, they'll revise history this time as well. Okay, in 1941, that didn't work. So in 1942, there was the Revenue Act of 1942, and the tax rate for the lowest income, the tax brackets went down to 24, lowest income 19%, highest rate 88% on $200,000. So they dropped it from $5 million to $200,000 for a top rate of 88%. Now this is inflation adjusted dollars. So that would mean if you made $200,000 today, if you lived then, you would pay an 88% tax rate. That would leave you with almost nothing. There's no incentive to work, really, when it gets that high. Because why go through all of that work to make the same as someone else? I mean, it's ridiculous. We had become a socialist country even then. Then in 1944, that rate went from the bottom. Of course, there was World War II that we had to finance, but we still had this progressive system, and we could have financed it with a flat rate, and our economy would have produced more. But there was a 23% bottom rate and a 91% top rate. That was called the Individual Income Tax Act of 1944. That 91% tax rate began for individuals making $200,000. That's inflation adjusted. If you want to know what $200,000 in 1944 is worth today, it's worth $2.54 million. But that's inflation adjusted, meaning that's when the highest tax rate began. So imagine yourself making $200,000 and having to pay 91% of your income, or maybe the adjustment here has to do with our adjustment. So really, the adjustment has to do with the fact if today you made $2.54 million, you would have to pay 91% income tax. And if in 1942 you made $200,000, that's the same as $2.75 million income per year, etc. And then we have it start to come down to 20% on the lowest rate as we end the war, still 91% at the top rate, and it remained that way from 1946 until 1964. And this says tax reduction during Vietnam War? No. This was the Kennedy tax reduction that went into effect in 1964. John F. Kennedy was all for tax rate decreases. Liberals don't want to admit it. But he didn't decrease it that much, really. But as part of the package, it continued to go down, as we note, even through 1964 and 1965. These were the Kennedy tax rate reductions, and they reduced from lowest of 16%, highest of 77%. That would be tantamount to paying 77% on $2.85 million. And then from 14 to 70%, and that would be 70% tantamount to $1.42 million. And then we had Ronald Reagan come into office, and his the beginning of his tax cuts was 12% for the lowest, and then 50. And then they kicked in again in 1987. By 1987, it was 11% and 38.5%. And by 1988, Reagan had got it down to two brackets. He got the closest ever during this century to what the Bible says a country should do. One flat rate. And I'm sure if it were up to him, he would have had one flat rate. But he had to deal with Congress, and you always have to do that. And it was amazing what he achieved. What did he achieve? 15% lowest rate and 28% highest rate. And the highest rate began at about $56,000 for our money Then in 1991, George H.W. Bush said, "Read my lips," and everybody did, and he raised taxes anyway. And they went from 28 to 31%. But the amount of that 31% actually increased to $135,000 is what you would have to make to pay that 31% rate. So it really wasn't that much of a tax increase, but it got him booted out of office. Then we got someone else in office named Bill Clinton, and it went from bottom rate 15% to 39.6%, tantamount to an income of $388,000. Then George W. Bush put in his tax cut, came back down to 35% for the top rate, came down even more for the bottom rate, down to 10%. That held true all the way through 2011. And then we just had an Obama tax increase in 2012. It's called a Taxpayer Relief Act, but I don't see any relief. I see it going up. There's 7 new brackets, and it goes back to the Clinton rate of 39.6%, and that 39.6% begins at an income of $400,000. But the principle you see is it's progressive. And Reagan has still had his impact because he simplified the tax code down to two individual tax rates. It's back up to 7 brackets now. But as you look through our history, it's been as high as 31 brackets in 1936 or 32 brackets in 1941 under Roosevelt. So we've been socialistic for quite a while and have not followed the Constitution. And I guarantee you these confiscatory tax rates of 67, 63, 79, 81, 88, 91, 91, that is socialism. And it's amazing this country made it through those days. Why? We had a pivot of mature believers is the only reason. Now again, with those high tax rates, even back then they had loopholes. And everybody will tell you, yeah, it was 70%, but there were loopholes that they could find. And it's true, but it locked up their money. And it kept economic growth to a minimum. Then when Reagan got in, the gross national product of the United States doubled due to his tax reform. And also due to a larger pivot here in the United States in the 1980s. The next thing I passed out is our gross public debt. That's how much debt we have. You see the chart there. You see it starts going up in 1980. We had a huge defense buildup during the 1980s, and also Congress, who controls the purse, would not hold back on spending. So they were spending more than was coming in, definitely, even though revenues doubled, so did the deficit. Then you see it kind of level out a little bit after the election of Newt Gingrich to Congress in 1994 until about 2000. Then 9/11 occurred. We had to spend money for that. And then we have the election of Barack Hussein Obama, and it just goes shooting way off the chart with no end in sight. This means national destruction. I was going to put the Bible verse in there concerning debt, that a client nation lends, it doesn't borrow, etc. That's in the Bible, but I didn't put it there. But it's something we may go over later. So you can see the fiscal problems of the United States right now. The fact that we are going totally broke. You cannot spend that much money and not go broke. It's like a family. It's impossible. Now let's look at another troublesome thing. We're kind of going backwards. That has to do with the third cycle of discipline. This has to do with the first and second cycle of discipline. In 1950, you can see the marriage rate for women who were for women was about 90%. Now the red line represents the women who are over 15. The blue line represents women aged 15 to 44. But the red line indicates all women. The blue line, for some reason, they wanted to go 15 to 44. I guess it gives you an idea of the generation there and how quickly it goes down per the generation. So you can see that gap widen as we get, you can see the gap widen, and at the same time you can see it pulling the red line down because the other generations die out, if you get my meaning. But we start out with a 90% rate for all women being married in 1950. That steadily declines until about around Kennedy's time, and then it kind of stops, and the marriage rate goes up a bit until about 1970. And then from there forward, it just dives. And from around the year 1973 onward, there's a rapid decline in marriage. I'm not talking about divorce. This is regarding marriage rates. And today it's down to 50% of all women are married that are over 15. But for my generation, those 15 to 44, the marriage rate is down to around 40%. So you can see the degeneration as far as age goes as well. The younger people aren't staying married or even getting married. They're just living with one another. So the marriage rate for the young people, 40%. In 1950, 85%. Don't tell me there's not a problem with this country. That's the first and second cycle of discipline. The first cycle dealing with social decline, the decline of marriage, the decline of the divine institutions. What are the divine institutions? Number one, volition, choice. You have an authority in your soul and freedom to use it. And they are definitely using their freedom to make bad decisions. Number two is marriage. Marriage is a divine institution, extraordinarily important to any nation, and especially a client nation to God. And if you would compare our numbers to the numbers in Asia, we're in real trouble. And all of this, these marriage rates, well, let's look at the divorce rate. Go on and flip to the next one. You'll see that about in 1984, it starts going, well, let's see, it's going backwards here. What is this? No. In about 1960, in the mid-1960s, it starts to jump up. And by 1970, in the mid-1960s, it's 10% divorce rate. And by 1970, it's up to 16%. By 1975, it's up to 22%. Now, this is including the entire population. You said, I thought 50% of people were getting divorced. They are. They're including the entire population. That means they're including unmarried people who don't have to get divorced. And then you see a decline from 1980 to 2000, but that's false. And they will use these figures. I've heard them on the news. Well, the divorce rate is down slightly. No. The marriage rate is so low that the divorce rate has to come down with it in terms of the entirety of the population. Do you understand? It all has to do with percentages. And in fact, the divorce rate, if you were to take the amount you can see, that the amount of people actually getting married has just continually fallen. And if you were to, say, include the breakups of people just living together and all of that, it would be astronomical. We've had a total social collapse in this country. That's why you're shocked when you put on television or hear some of the things the young people are listening to today. It's complete and utter and total degeneracy. And all of that has to do with the first and second cycle of discipline. The second cycle of discipline is an intensification of these social problems, plus the addition of terrorism that occurred on 9/11. And we've been concerned about terrorism ever since. So we're already functioning under the first, second, and as I showed you previously, from our national debt skyrocketing, third cycle of discipline. And they all tend to go together. Because the next one says female and male-headed families. This means single-parent household. female single parent household and male single parent household. And notice, they both go up. It really begins to spike around 1970. But it had been going up since 1950. The Leave It to Beaver years, all the way. And the male-headed families, that didn't really start going up until about 1975. The female-headed families started continually rising to about 10% in 1970, and now it's about 25%. It doesn't take it out through today. Now it's well over a quarter. I heard it on the news. So that line just kept going up. Single-family homes. Now that's a detriment to the economy, because I also looked up some figures on poverty. Single-family homes live in poverty at an enormous rate. I think I put something out of order here. I should have put this in the economic stack, but it's total spending for the United States. And it's a chart here. And that this might shock you. Everybody thinks we spend so much on the military. No, we don't. We do not. In fact, military is a part, as a percentage of our gross domestic product, is the lowest it's been since World War II. Since before World War I, when we spent hardly anything on our military. The size of our Navy is as small as it was before World War I, and that was a time when we didn't spend anything on military. We didn't think we had to. We were a world away from Europe. The world seemed bigger then, and we just didn't think that we needed to concern ourselves with Europe or with the world, that we could isolate ourselves and be just fine and not have a military. Well, that turned out to be wrong. It's biblically wrong, too, especially for a client nation. Notice this. What is most of everything spent on? And this is a percentage of the pie cut up of your tax money. Where does your tax money go? Most of it goes to health care, 19% of it. And that's going to rise significantly. The second part goes to pensions. Government workers, their pensions. The third part goes to education, and pensions is 18%. Education is 15%. Defense is only 13% of our budget. People think cutting defense will, we could disarm ourselves completely and still have a deficit. That's just stupid thinking. And people don't know these facts. That's why they get away with lying to us. Welfare is 9%. The interest on the debt is 5%. And if that interest ever just doubles, right now it's very, very low. And if the interest doubles, well, that goes to 10%, and we are really in trouble. We are on the brink. Other spending, that means waste, pork, 9%. General government, 3%. Transportation, 4%. And protection, whatever that means, I guess Homeland Security, 4%. So you see, we're not spending enough on defense. We have far too many welfare programs. And our government is far too deep into the healthcare system. It would be much cheaper if they would start throwing money around at it. I mean, when you're paying $10 for an aspirin, there's something wrong, but they can charge that because the federal government pays for it, which is us. I have something here I didn't give you. The United States has fallen to number 7 among the richest countries in the world. All of that's part of the third cycle of discipline. If you want, just for the sake of curiosity and your knowledge, number 10, well, let's start with the richest. Number 1 is Qatar. Now, they're the richest because of us, of course. Their population isn't very large, 1.8 million people. But they are the richest, with an annual average income of $100,000 per year. That's because we buy their oil. Hopefully that will quit someday. Second was Singapore. That was the country I was trying to tell you about the other day that wanted to cane whip one of our citizens because they messed up with their country. Singapore has a population of 5.3 million people, a per capita income of $60,000 per year. Well, that's number three. Number two is Luxembourg. Luxembourg's a tiny country in Western Europe. Theirs is $80,000 a year. They only have about a 500,000 population. So you see, they're rich, but they don't have much power to go with it because there's not a lot of population. $60,000 in Singapore. And that was number three. Number four is Norway. Norway is in the Scandinavian area, north of England. There's 5 million people. They make $50,000 a year. Brunei is in Southeast Asia. Population 408,000. They make $49,500. That's number five. Number six is, I believe it's Hong Kong. Let me get to it. Number six is United Arab Emirates. The papers are screwed up here. They make about $49,500 as well. Not very many people there. Number seven, the United States of America, 48,328, population 313 million. That's why we are the superpower of the world. Then we have Asia with Hong Kong at number six, and they have 49,417. They got a picture here of Hong Kong. It's beautiful. That'd be a nice place to go to on vacation. But anyway, all of this signifies the fact that we as a client nation are under punishment. The statistics show it, and it's been a steady decline for a long time. So we're under the third cycle of discipline now. The next stage is the fourth, and that one you won't like at all, just like you don't like the third one. Now, a client nation to God is a nation under divine protection. It's under divine protection because it has a large pivot of mature believers. These mature believers have blessing by association to those who are around them. They have historical blessing to their nation. A client nation is restored by the spinoff of reversionistic believers. They're not part of the pivot. And they have their rejection of Bible doctrine is the reason why the country goes under, and they are traitors. Believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, traitors to their own country, because they won't take out an hour a day to listen to the Word of God. They won't make it part of their life, even. They won't even give it a hearing. So as the pivot shrinks, the nation loses its client's nation status to God, and it begins to undergo the five cycles of discipline. Only a remnant of the believers had impact through their spiritual life in the time of Israel in the Old Testament, and only a remnant believers today have impact in the United States. The divine meanings of history has always concerned and been about client nations. Now, the key to client nations is, of course, found in history as Israel, as the priest nation. And God directs and controls historical activity on the basis of client nations. That's why Satan's going to dance a jig when the resurrection occurs, because at that point, no more client nations in his way. Nothing to control his schemes, to put a damper on his schemes. That's why he so hates the United States, and so seeks its downfall, and so seeks to internally destroy it. But God directs and controls historical activity on the basis of the client nation. And a client nation is responsible to do five things. Number one, it must evangelize its own population at home. A client nation must evangelize its own population at home. We are failing to do so. Most believers don't even know how to evangelize. They don't know how to give the simple gospel of Christ. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Those who believe in Christ shall see life. Those who do not believe shall not see life. But the wrath of God shall abide on them forever. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. and no one knows how to evangelize anymore. I'm going to have to take it upon myself when I have time to do it myself. And I'm a pastor, and my job is to study and teach, but it is also my responsibility to do the work of an evangelist, because so many evangelists have failed. So we failed in that area. Number two, it must communicate Bible doctrine to the believers in the nation. We have a few Bible doctrinal teachers scattered throughout the country, and that's it. It's not enough. And most of them have small congregations. The client state of Texas has a few. I mean, they have a bigger church. There's a pivot in Texas. You can tell by their attitude and by their thinking. You can tell the influence of the pivot in Texas. You can't tell the influence of any pivot, especially in the Northeast or the West Coast. It's gone. Number three, it is responsible for the custodianship of Bible doctrine. So far, so good. I don't know anyone else in the world teaching Bible doctrine. They all seem to live in the United States. Of course, there are missionaries, but that's a separate thing. I'm talking about we are the custodians of the word and we send it out. No other nation around the world, even with our paltry pivot, seems to care. But that can change in a New York minute. Could change here. We could continue to be the client nation. We just need a revival, just like we've had in every generation. And once we have a revival, and if we have a revival of believers getting on the Word of God, all of those stats that I showed you would turn around. Divine establishment principles would come back into play because of blessing by association. Number four, it provides a haven for the Jews. We still provide a haven for the Jews. We're not persecuting them yet. Well, not really. I heard the IRS was persecuting conservatives and Jews, but it's a sparse thing that's going on. I don't know how widespread, but if you're in an organization that gives money and you're in a Jewish organization, you've been spotted by our government and harassed. So we're heading in that direction, but so far so good. So far, we got two out of four. Number five, it is responsible to send out missionaries to evangelize other nations. We're having a hard enough time evangelizing our own, so we're failing in that area. We have a few who do it, like Moses on Wabiko and a few others, but not enough. We're failing in that area. So three out of five, we're failing. Now, there were five Jewish client nations in the Old Testament. We won't go over those. I'll just mention them quickly. The Theocratic Kingdom, 1441 B.C. to 1020. The United Kingdom from Saul to Rehoboam, that would be 1020 to 926. The Northern Kingdom from Jeroboam to Hosea, B.C. 926 to 721. In 721, the fifth cycle of discipline came to the Northern Kingdom. The Southern Kingdom hung around, and that was from Rehoboam to Zedekiah, 926 to 586. And then in 586 B.C., the fifth cycle of discipline also came to the Southern Kingdom, and Nebuchadnezzar took over the Southern Kingdom. And then it took all the pivot, or there was no pivot left. It took the remnant, and it took it with them to what is actually Chaldea. And there, Nebuchadnezzar actually became a believer, the greatest king in all the world. Took him a while. He had to eat grass and go nuts. But once he recovered from his insanity, he believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and so did many others in that area, believed in Christ. And then eventually, after the northern and southern kingdom were destroyed, during that time there was no operational client nation as such. The Jews outside of the client nation filled in the gap for the Gentile nations, as they had been responsible before to do so. In other words, they evangelized while under captivity. And at this point, actually, no Gentile client nation exists in the Old Testament, so at this point, there was no client nation on the earth. It had been wiped out. There are only Jewish client nations in the Old Testament. And then in 516, Judah became a client nation again. They went back to the land. So there was a time from 586 to 516. I want you to notice something. What's 16 minus 86? 70. And the reason why we have this 70-year time, well, it was to reflect the fact that they had not followed the law in which every 7 years they were to, as part of the law, you see, they would acquire property like we do, but their law was different. We acquire property, it's ours. We die, it goes to our those whom we wish to inherit it to. Now in Israel, they would keep the property for 70 years, and they could pass it down. I believe this is correct, 70 years. I'll look it up, and if I'm wrong, I'll tell you tomorrow, but it is a time period that they must keep it, and I think it's 70, because right here we have them 70 years in captivity. Then after 70 years, it must go back to the original owner, and therefore it would go back to a family member of the original owner, and the whole country's economy would start all over again. And this is the system God designed. You say, why would all of a sudden you're doing all this? And now you have this great property, and let's say you have to exchange property now with this guy, and all he's got's a trailer, and you got a $2 million mansion. Oops. You had to do it. It was to show grace. It was also to keep the economy level, in which everyone would always have an opportunity if they had the drive to become wealthy. And believe you me, and it also kept an aristocracy from becoming corrupt. The wealth being handed down from generation to generation to generation oftentimes leads to corruption, hence the Kennedy family. They become spoiled. So they switch it out, and then they have to show if that family still has the ability to go out in capitalism and make it again. And then that family that suddenly is rich, they have to show that they can make it with their wealth. But that was God's system that was set up. That's not a system we should follow, nor do we follow it. That was for the client nation, and they would not follow that. Yeah, question? They give it back to the other family, the other original owners. It just goes back to the original owner. That's all it says. I'll look it up more for you, but I was just going to go over this in a glance, but I haven't studied it in detail, to be honest with you. But I do know that as part of the reason why they stayed in 70 years captivity was because they stopped this system. They would not follow this system. They became too greedy. The wealthy became too greedy, and they wouldn't do it. And if the poor person from the other family came up and said, hey, it's time for the returning of the property, they would laugh at them. It's just not going to happen. So God said, all right, you won't follow my laws? You'll spend 70 years in slavery. I'll get that information since it's interesting. And also give it to you tomorrow. So after the northern and southern kingdoms were destroyed, there was no client nation during that 70-year time period. But in B.C. 516, the nation of Judah arose. And there's a great story out of that. And that's where we get Hanukkah, by the way, during that revival of the Jews in 1516. And they still celebrate Hanukkah today as part of Judah retaining or receiving back its freedom. That nation lasted from 516 BC to August of 70 AD. Chaldea and the Persian Empire were not client nations to God, even though Daniel was there and such, and even though the king Nebuchadnezzar believed in Christ. They could not function as a client nation because it was the time of the Jews. And we'll get to the time of the Gentiles in Acts. Client nation is still a principle of history. So again, no client nation was on the earth between 586 and 516 B.C. The numbers go backwards, you know. In B.C., if it's 586, next year will be 585. Next year will be 584. So 586 to 516, and that's correct. B.C., 586 to 516. In 458 B.C., after the fifth Jewish client nation became operational, we have the return of Ezra. The entire Old Testament canon was then discovered, and Ezra led a great revival back to Bible doctrine. In 445 B.C., Nehemiah returned with a group of people to rebuild the walls and to organize a military to defend this client nation to God. So that's the history of client nation Israel, the pattern that is followed today among Gentile client nations. Except we have one extra rule. We have to provide a haven for the Jews, of which we've done a pretty good job at. There have been times of anti-Semitism even in this country, but during that time it was really around the world. It's a very terrible time of history. That would be prior to World War II, which is why we had to go through such vicious things, because God had to do a cleansing. The whole world was becoming anti-Semitic. Anyway, negative volition to Bible doctrine destroys the client nation. So if you're negative toward doctrine, you're a traitor as a believer. Now, there were times of apostasy in Israel in the Old Testament, of course. And apostasy in a nation is always a cancer. If it's allowed to grow long enough, that client nation dies under the fifth cycle of discipline. And in every case of Jewish apostasy, in a Jewish client nation, the status of both the clergy and the politicians of Israel are indicted along with the negative volition of the people. Turn in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 13. Jeremiah 6:13. It's important because we are a reflection of the days of Israel during Jeremiah's day. Jeremiah 6:13. Jeremiah 6:13. It's going to sound awfully familiar. Not just the verse, but it's going to sound familiar in the sense of this is the way the United States is going. That's Luke's favorite drink, Coca-Cola. Although he does like Mountain Dew, he says it's spicy. He loves spicy. He's really referring to the carbonation. Jeremiah 6:13 through 14. For from the least of them, even to the greatest of them, everyone is greedy for profit. Furthermore, from the prophet, that would be the teacher who should be teaching Bible doctrine, even to the priest, the symbol, everyone manufactures lies. You're all being lied to. In fact, they allege to solve the problems of my people, saying peace and prosperity. You have peace, peace. But shalom, shalom, in Hebrew, when it's doubled like that, it's usually a greeting, and it means peace and prosperity to you, is what it's saying. So peace and prosperity, when there is no peace and prosperity. That's what we hear today from a lot of politicians. We're going to have peace and prosperity. In fact, we've been in if you watch the news, we've been in a recovery since the president took office. Have we now? I can pull off statistics right now from the internet and show you that our income has fallen from 55,000 to 48,000. That's why we went to number 7 on the list of most prosperous nations. That's a recovery, and they even reported it. Well, our income has fallen from 55 to 48,000 during this recovery. What kind of recovery is that? If you call that a recovery, I want no part of it. I call that going backwards. That's not, so they're saying prosperity, prosperity. Pay no attention to the numbers. Don't confuse me with the facts. That's just how they were. Peace and prosperity when there is no peace and prosperity. We had the Middle East not too long ago erupt in complete violence against the United States of America, and now we have Egypt going crazy. Peace? I remember when the Middle East didn't say a peep when someone else was in office. They were scared. They should have been. Not anymore. Now let's look at Ezekiel 13:10. I love this verse. It's fabulous. It definitely deals with the politicians of our day. And it also deals with believers, which makes it even more fabulous because it tells the people, you're responsible, not the politicians, the priests, etc. Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 10. Ezekiel 13:10. You might have to crack that one there, although we've studied it before years ago, so your Bible might flop there easily. But if you haven't studied under me for that many years, not too many people open up Ezekiel. Ezekiel 13:10. It is definitely because they have misled my people, saying, peace, when there is no peace. Now, when anyone builds a wall, that means the politician builds a wall of lies. Behold, they cover it with whitewash. That means they have false solutions to the problems of the client nation, and they whitewash the problems of the client nation, such as, we are in a recovery. Yes, your income's gone down. Yes, one out of four of your children have come back to live with you. Yes, you might only find a part-time job or none at all. Yes, you might be on unemployment. And yes, food stamps might have gone up by 14,000% or 1,400%, which is true. That is a fact. But, it's not that bad. We're recovering. That's whitewash. That's trying to make something pretty that looks terrible. And I've seen it all across many areas of the country. Some areas of the country haven't been as hard as others. Like Indianapolis, that doesn't look like it's been hit too hard at all. You drive through Toledo, up through Detroit, it's been hit hard. Drive back to my old stomping ground, Spartanburg, South Carolina, it's been hit hard, I can tell. They were tearing down things, businesses were boarded up. Some of the businesses that I used to wash windows for, my dad owned a window washing business, are gone. Just gone. Tore down. And the other two that were on each side of that building are out of business. So yeah, they were hit hard. And every part of the country has been hit in some way. Some parts have been hit harder than others. The South has been hit especially hard. And guess what? That's where most of the believers are. In fact, they allege to solve problems of my people, saying, well, that was the other verse. We're talking about the wall, and they're covering it with whitewash, and then it continues. So tell those who plaster it over with whitewash that it will fall. Yesterday on the news, they had about three consecutive people talking about the fact that we are facing the fall of the United States. Yet all the politicians and all the people walk around fat, dumb, and happy because it's plastered with whitewash. A flooding rain will come, and you, O hailstones, will fall. And a violent wind, this is referencing the fifth cycle of discipline, will break out. Behold, when the wall has fallen, will you not be asked? Where is the plaster with wherewith you have plastered it? Therefore, thus says the Lord God, I will cause a violent wind to break out in my wrath. There will also be in my anger, anthropathism, anthropopathism because God can never be angry, but it's to explain his attitude toward the decline of a nation, a client nation. There will also be in my anger a flooding rain and hailstones to consume it in wrath. So I shall tear down the wall. What wall? The wall of political lies, which you plastered over with whitewash, and bring it down to the ground, so that its foundation is laid bare. Furthermore, when it falls, you will be destroyed with it. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Therefore, I will spend my wrath against the wall and against those who have plastered it over with whitewash. Then I will say to you, the wall is gone, along with all its plasterers, along with the prophets of Israel who should have been teaching doctrine, along with the prophets of Israel who prophesied to Yerushalayim and saw visions of peace for her when there was no peace or prosperity, declares the Lord God. Declares the Lord God. So some quick principles from this. You don't have to write them down. I'll go through them quickly. We've studied client nation before, but we're at a time when we need to be reminded of it. Principle one, good decisions of national leadership result in greater options for greater decisions. Bad decisions destroy freedom options and enslave the nation, so that the client nation status is destroyed from within in the first three cycles of discipline. That should send chills down your spine. We're being destroyed from within, and it's obvious. A nation that's not prepared for war is not prepared for peace. We are cutting our military at a time when we are at war. It's ridiculous. Principle two, mankind has always been and will always be a product of their own volition and not their environment. We blame environment oftentimes, and that's part of the arrogant skills. I do this, thus, and so, and this, and so, because I was abused as a child or dropped on my head, etc. No, you don't. That's the arrogant skills. You have volition. Principle three, the doctrine of man's sin nature and total depravity, plus the function of the Satan's cosmic system, requires that people in a client nation will periodically have to make great sacrifices for their freedom, and that would be through freedom through military victory. Principle four, political solutions are useless without the spiritual solution. The only thing that makes a political solution great is the invisible heroship of the mature believer. If you refer back to that tax thing that I gave you, the income tax, and how high it was all the way until Ronald Reagan came into office, and then you see it drop dramatically, and you see our military rise in such power that right after Ronald Reagan left office, down came the Soviet Union and the wall that separated East from West. What caused all that? The pivot. And the pivot allowed for a great leader to rise up. So the pivot allowed for the great leader to rise up. For without the spiritual solution, the political solutions are useless. So obviously, we had a large pivot in the 1980s. Because we went back to a time period that hadn't been seen since the 19-teens. It's absolutely phenomenal. And we had prosperity out the wazoo. People were making hand over fist, money, money, money. Crime rates started going down. Everything. Drug abuse went way down. People became vigorous, all because of a pivot. All because of one man, Colonel R B Thieme Jr., who was responsible for the formation of that pivot, but it was, of course, the positive volition of believers during that time. And also, the pivot was so large, it had an effect in Great Britain. And there were people listening to Colonel Thieme in Great Britain, and they got the Iron Lady. So we had a twofer there, the Iron Lady along with Ronald Reagan. And they both straightened out an awful situation. But it was all because of a spiritual solution, the pivot of mature believers. Political solutions are temporal. Just look at that chart again. Or just look at that income tax thing. See how temporal it is? One moment it's 7% for the highest rate. The next moment it's 67% 3 years later. So political solutions are temporal. Spiritual solutions are eternal. So we must think and live our lives in the light of eternity. Political solutions relate to the power of man, but spiritual solutions relate to the power of God. Political solutions are often erroneous and destructive to a nation, and we're going through that. Socialism, destructive to a nation, erroneous. It is destructive and offers no hope. You hear a lot about hope. Socialism offers no hope to a nation. Political solutions are mortal and subject to corruption. Spiritual solutions are eternal and compatible with the immortality of the soul. Political solutions grope in darkness of spiritual death. But spiritual solutions live in light, their lives in the light of eternity and have a fantastic divine revelation in time. Political solutions are related to the first birth of mankind and are related to the fact of his spiritual death. Spiritual solutions are related to the regeneration, the second birth, to be born again through faith in Christ. That is the second birth of mankind and his eternal relationship with God. Spiritual solutions never include violence or coercion, but a change in the soul through Bible doctrine. I've talked to far too many people who have wanted to go out and have a revolution or to get out in the streets and get angry at what's happening. Again, I tell you, you are symptom shadow boxing. Can't blame the political leaders. You can only blame yourself, especially if you think you can turn the world upside down in the energy of the flesh. The only way you can turn the world upside down is in the power of God the Holy Spirit, utilizing the power of Bible doctrine, just as Paul did. And Paul lived during a time in which Christians went through great suffering and great persecution. And he went from city to city all across the Roman Empire. He even wanted to go to Spain, but there was no positive volition in Spain, so God stopped him at Rome, where he wanted him to be, and threw him in jail. And he threw him in jail because the Apostle Paul wouldn't stop moving around with his missionary activity of evangelizing. And it was time, at this time, he had done enough evangelizing. Other people were also evangelizing. He had done enough. He had fulfilled his, as you would say, as a hunter goes out and shoots deer, he had fulfilled his tickets. He had punched them all, and he was done, but he didn't want to be done. He wanted to go to Spain. And Paul was hard-headed. I'm going to keep going. So God threw him in a jail in Rome, but it wasn't a jail. He was under house arrest. And he was allowed visitors to bring him food and water and amenities. It wasn't that bad. Therefore, he got a chance to sit down and write the epistles. Many of the epistles, not all of them, but many of them, he wrote right there under house arrest. It was the only way he was going to do it, and God had to put him there and sit him down and say, write! Well, he had to do something. God knew he would write. That was the Apostle Paul. If he wasn't running around from country to country, or all across the Roman Empire, we would say from country to country, because the Roman Empire covered almost the whole of the known world at the time. But he had finished with his missionary work. It's now time for him to sit down and write the Bible, the epistles, of which he wrote most of them, a vast majority of them. So just as Paul turned the world upside down, you too have that capability, because you have the spiritual life, the post-canon spiritual life of the church age. There's never been anything like it. As per 1 Peter 2:5 and 2:9, you are a royal priest. You represent yourself before God, and through your own privacy, you can execute the protocol plan of God and therefore become part of whatever is left of this paltry pivot that we have and turn the world upside down. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, Father, we thank you for the wonderful wonderful time we have had to and freedom to study this portion of the Word. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen.